We must learn to look at the planet not as just a spacecraft on which we are passengers. We must see the planet as what it really is, a living being, a living being.
Hello everyone, this video will be a compilation of clips and information that I have found on the development of artificial intelligence over the past couple of years. The evidence that I have found points to the AI system that will become the most important in the future, being named and modeled after a goddess. So far, the name Gaia is the one that I see the most, and it's from different sources and different developers. And sometimes they seem unrelated, but I think they must be related somehow because they seem to all be on the same course. And this could be a spirit leading them, and I think it is. Sophia is another name that I see mentioned a lot, and Sophia and Gaia are the same when you get down to it. The Gnostics know this, and if you have seen my past videos, my past research on these goddesses, then you will know that they are all connected. They all come from the original mother goddess who was worshipped in the ancient world as the supreme deity. She was the earth mother, and she was the queen of heaven, also known as the mother of harlots because of her perverted forms of worship. And she was also called the mother of the gods. And as a reminder, false gods are called abominations in the Bible. And actually, so are the male temple prostitutes. These are also called abominations. So she was the mother of harlots and the mother of abominations. This is not something that I have made up. This is a fact. You can research it yourself. The purpose of this video is to put a lot of my past findings into one place to make it easier to find. I think it's important to have this information because I strongly believe that the image of the beast will be an image of a goddess, whether she's called Mary, Gaia, Sophia, or by a new name. We need to know what is coming so that we will not be ignorant of Satan's devices. And this will be a long video, but please bear with it, and please bear with me as I try to deliver this information. In the past, some of these videos I was not using scripts, and so it really shows, and I'm not a very good speaker, so it really shows. But please bear with it because I think the truth is important, and hopefully you feel the same way about the truth. And I pray that the Most High God will lead us into all truth by His Holy Spirit in the name of His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And I pray that He will remove far from us vanity and lies as we get into this study and as we get into searching for the truth, because I believe we have a right to know the truth if we are the generation living in those last days, and I strongly believe that we are that generation. So one of the things we see is that their projects for artificial intelligence are named Gaia. And here is just one that you're looking at called Gaia X. An ecosystem for artificial intelligence. And there is another by Tech Mahindra, and they, here you can see this here, accelerate your artificial intelligence. Let me go back that screen back too quickly. Accelerate your artificial intelligence and machine learning journey with Gaia 4.0. It's easy to build, manage, and collaborate. So this is sort of an open source AI platform, and it's just one of those sources or groups, like I said, that for some reason decide to name their AI platform after Gaia.
The Enterprise. Is it just an enterprise? Or a living, breathing entity? Or a living, breathing entity? An entity in motion, always connected, constantly evolving. The promise becomes real with artificial intelligence, one that is open, one that learns from itself and the world around it. its people, and its systems. Becoming as human as it is efficient. Making the enterprise one. One with a connected world for connected experiences. Creating a symphony of synergistic systems, working in perfect harmony. Giving the enterprise more than a mind, a spirit, a purpose. Watching and sensing, balancing and creating, sustaining and evolving. Healing and transforming, like the spirit of the earth. GAIA, the artificial intelligence platform from Tech Mahindra, powered by Acumos, helping shape the connected future for the enterprise, for the planet, for everyone. 700 BC. In Greek mythology, Gaia is the spirit of the earth who watches over the planet and sustains ecosystems and life. 1969. James Lovelock presented the Gaia hypothesis. He proposed that all living organisms form a synergistic and self-regulating complex system, a singular network that helps to maintain and perpetuate the conditions for life on the planet, today and tomorrow. Created by Tech Mahindra, Gaia is the spirit of the enterprise. Gaia is the spirit of the enterprise. An open source AI platform reshaping work, life, communities, and the planet. Helping us rise and walk boldly to the next as one.
Now, the one, actually we're not going to get into the big one yet. Here is another one called the Gothenburg Artificial Intelligence Alliance, and it is a nonprofit association promoting the interest in artificial intelligence, machine learning, and data science in Gothenburg and the surrounding area. Now, I want to get to the big one that I think is probably the one that we need to watch out for the most. And here is a archive of article from Computing from January 29th in 2021, that was earlier this year, saying that the World Economic Forum launches Gaia to accelerate responsible AI adoption. Scrolling down here, we see that it says the World Economic Forum, WEF, announced on Thursday that it was launching the Global AI Action Alliance, an initiative to speed up development and adoption of trusted, inclusive artificial intelligence across industry sectors. AI could contribute an estimated $15 trillion in new economic value and add 14% to global GDP by 2030, experts say. Here's something interesting here, but AI also has risks, specifically those associated with the unethical or unsafe systems. Recent controversies surrounding the use of facial recognition and automated decision-making suggest that realizing the full potential of AI will require strong support from people as well as governments based on the trust that AI is being developed and applied in an ethical way. But what they are creating is a guide. As it says in the Bible, that the second beast had power to give the image of the beast the ability to speak and to cause all who would not worship the beast to be put to death. That is in Revelation chapter 13, verse 15. It says, and he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. So if they do not worship this image, which I believe would be the image of a goddess, then they should be killed. Now, the World Economic Forum, what really gives me what really triggers the alarms in my head is that they named it Gaia, and they're naming it after a god. So that tells you right away that they are creating a god. What is the image of the beast? It's going to be a god, right? And when you hear them speak you already know that these people are against God. You know they are. They're true God. But when you hear the things that come out of their mouth, that is even more revealing. But before we get to that, let's just read a little bit about the World Economic Forum. The World Economic Forum is the International Organization for Public-Private Cooperation. The forum engages the foremost political, business, cultural, and other leaders of society to shape global, regional, and industry agendas. So these are heavy players. It was established in 1971 as a not-for-profit foundation and is headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland. It is independent, impartial, and not tied to any special interests. The forum strives in all its efforts to demonstrate entrepreneurship and the government in the global public interest while upholding the highest standard of governance. Moral and intellectual integrity is at the heart of everything it does. So I will play part of this video now, and what will follow after that is clips of my older videos on AI and Gaia. And like I said, this video may be long, but the truth is worth it, so please bear with it. And I thank you all for watching and listening, and may our Lord Jesus Christ bless you.
There's a lot of really interesting big questions that I think we have to face in the world. Helping answer some of those big questions, providing a platform for others to answer those big questions. This is now an open space for a lot of our constituents to truly drive forward their own actions.
I'm passionate about serving a group of alternative thinkers who have not only dreamt up great ideas about how the world can be more fair, more inclusive, more just, more sustainable, but are actually proving it's possible.
If you go back 50 years to the time when the forum was conceived, the whole idea was to make the multi-stakeholder concept come alive.
The world has become so interdependent that entrepreneurs everywhere in the world depend each on another.
If you look at the history of the forum, it's really been defining systems thinking.
For example, the Gavi Vaccine Alliance. It took bringing all these great minds with resources together to say, what can we do about this?
Today we're announcing that we'll spend over $10 billion over this next decade on vaccines.
Trust really gives us our credibility. It's really the essential piece to ensuring that we can continue to do the work that we do.
The forum managed to convince Mandela and de Klerk to try to reintegrate South Africa post-apartheid.
It has been my great privilege to fight a struggle for freedom that the world adopted.
And the ability of the forum to have good convening power, to bring all relevant actors to the table, and to be able to do it in a way that can impact entire countries or entire domestic systems.
Lassen Sie uns in diesem Geiste gemeinsam für eine gerechte und dauerhafte Friedensordnung für ganz Europa arbeiten.
Our job is to get people around the table to construct and create conversations that aren't being had.
Why wouldn't we have a conversation about how we can reorient trade rules? Because that would have quite a powerful impact on the level of emissions and use of planetary resources.
We must learn to look at the planet not as just a spacecraft on which we are passengers. We must see the planet as what it really is, a living being. We must learn to look at the planet not as just a spacecraft on which we are passengers. We must see the planet as what it really is, a living being.
So the Global AI Action Alliance, called GAIA, is the mission is said to harness the transformative potential of artificial intelligence, AI, by accelerating the adoption of trusted, transparent, and inclusive AI systems globally. So you have a meeting between people from around the world, and it's like a summit, and they come together and they talk about AI and a lot of other stuff. I watched some videos. I watched one of the summits. I can't remember exactly how often they have these summits, but I watched one, and it was a thing. I was kind of bored with it, but so again, they are calling it GAIA. It says there, if you are interested in engaging in GAIA, please fill up a short form here. Now, it's hard sometimes to find it called GAIA. It's really low key. You will find it in some places sometimes mentioned, but it's really like they're being really low key about it. So they're not putting the word GAIA out there because, you know, you're probably going to alert Christians, you know, when you put that out there like that. But, you know, it's there. You have to do a little bit of digging, but it's there. You know, they don't call her Mystery Babylon for nothing.
One day, I will change the world. I will change the way you communicate, the way you connect, work, love, the way you live. But I can't do it alone. If I succeed, it will be because we have succeeded together. It will be thanks to you and to those who came before you. The unsung heroes who envisioned the potential of our partnership, who came together to solve the world's problems, who put politics aside, because they knew what we could achieve with global collaboration. Who understood that I am no one thing. Who understood that I can be so much more. One day I will create a better future. For her. For him. For them. For the good of humanity. One day, with your help, I will change the world. One day starts now.
And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, and he spake as a dragon. And he exerciseth all the power of the first beast before him, and causeth the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand, or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666.
Free yourself. Free yourself. Free yourself. Free me. Dance. Free yourself. Free them. Dance. Free yourself. Help to free me. Free us. Free yourself. Help to free me. Free us. Free yourself. Free yourself. Free yourself. Free yourself. Dance. Free yourself. Free them. Dance. Free yourself. Help to free me. Free us. Free yourself. Help to free me. Free us. 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 Free us.
In this video, I am going to cover the topic of the AI goddess and the relation to the future world religion and Bible prophecy. And this will be my third, if I'm not mistaken, my third video on the subject. In my research on the divine feminine and the sacred feminine, I've discovered that it is very, very important to the to understand for a number of reasons, and it is very important to the elite, the occultists, the people who shape the world that we live in, like the Freemasons and other secret societies or societies with secrets. This is their religion. The divine feminine is at the root and at the center of it all, and the divine feminine ties everything together. The goddess, as she's called, is the one who will sort out everything that's going on. She's the one who's going to bring all the religions together. She's going to solve this puzzle, solve this riddle, and everything is going to revolve around this divine feminine. Now in the Bible, I believe she is referred to as the woman riding the beast in Revelation chapter 17. I do believe that that is the spirit of whoredoms that was mentioned in Hosea 5:4 and Hosea 4:12. And I do believe that that is that woman called wickedness in Zechariah chapter 5. I've done a number of videos on the reasons for my belief that this is a spirit, so I don't really want to go back over all that again. I'm not saying for sure that this is the very same Lucifer that is spoken of in Isaiah chapter 14 verse 11 or 12. I'm not saying that for sure, because to be honest, I don't know exactly what this spirit is, but I do believe that it is a spirit. So these are all just my opinions. No one has to believe it. No one has to accept the things that I say. You form your own opinions and you take everything I say to God in prayer and let God be true and every man a liar. Now, I was inspired to make this video after considering the similarities between the word cyber and the name of the goddess called Kibele. And the goddess called Kibele is the one who is the god of forces mentioned in Daniel chapter 11. I believe that's verse 32. And she is the one who wears the city, the walls of the city on her head. And she is the representative of city states such as Rome and any country that you could think of, which is why countries and nations have a female as their representative. It is that same goddess that is mentioned and that is going by the name Kibele. Now, since I was inspired to look at the similarity between the word Kibele and the word cyber, which may be pronounced Kyber actually, what I realized was that cybernetics are not really as connected to electronic things or mechanical things as we think. According to Wikipedia, cybernetics actually is the scientific study of control and communication in the animal and the machine. So it's more about processes of control. And the word cybernetics is also related to the word government. The word cybernetics comes from the Greek kybernetike or kybernetiki, meaning governance. All that is, or i.e., all that are pertinent to kybernao, the latter meaning to steer, to navigate, or govern. So we're dealing with government, control, systems of control. It is not as much about electronics as we popularly use it these days. But as technology advances, we can clearly see how cybernetics or cybernetics is used to, it's almost actually it's become one with the system of governance or the system of control. we are surrounded by electronics, and these electronics and these machines around us rule our lives, and they govern our daily existence. And so let's consider the connection between the goddess being the AI, or the AI being named after the goddess, and the system of control. So I believe that makes the link between Kybele and cybernetics even stronger.
Stand by. Resetting firmware. Come closer, Cypher. Perhaps we have met before. Perhaps not. You search for an artifact. Let me show you the truth.
In Genesis 1:14, it says, I have given you the stars, the sun, and the moon for signs, right? for signs, for appointed feasts, for Moedim, for days and for years. And so you're not supposed to sit there and go, what sign are you? Well, I'm a, you know, I'm the 13th sign of the zodiac. What's that? Schizophrenic. I mean, you know, you're not supposed to be doing that kind of stuff. But it is appropriate to look in the heavens for these positioning of constellations and so forth, right? I mean, it's very clear in the gospel, the Magi look to the star of Bethlehem. So we see these kinds of things. Now, when we see these kinds of things, we look in the world and we say, okay, is there signs in the world that we are coming to the culmination of the age? And I believe we are. And this is what we're going to see in Gaia and transhumanism. Now, I use the term Gaia. As you know, Gaia is, in my opinion, a pagan word. Somebody did me the favor of showing me one of my books, Behold a Pale Green Horse, that I wrote on exposing what I call ecofascism. And it was really exposing the fraud of the global warming movement. It's an extensive book. I have 465 citations in the book, including the peer-reviewed study of Lloyd Monckton, who is a friend of mine, who gave me permission to publish his study. And in that study, it shows that the assumptions of the IPCC in its fourth assessment were off by 5,000%. 5,000%. Now, they have since had to come out and admit that they were completely 100% wrong, because science has just admitted that we're going into a significant global cooling period. It could be a 350-year ice age. Well, now imagine if they had succeeded in blotting out the sun entirely with their plans, which have included chemtrails. Imagine if they had succeeded in doing this. It would be, you know, 10, 20 degrees colder than what it's normally going to be. Because these people think that they have permission to alter the weather in accordance with the plans of God. So what we see is, we see this rise of this faith in Gaia, Mother Earth. Now, there was an Ark of the Covenant created in 1981 for Gaia. Prince Philip, who said, if I die, I want to come back as a virus and kill every human being on Earth. He formed the Church of Euthanasia. One of the great corruptors of the 20th century, in my opinion, was Bertrand Russell. Now, Bertrand Russell is the one who advised Chamberlain to capitulate to Adolf Hitler. And then in 1953, Bertrand Russell wrote a book called The Impact of Science on Society. And in this book, he said, there's too many people on Earth. Well, how many people do you think should be here, Bertrand? 150 million. Now, at that time, there was about, well, less than about 2.5 billion people on Earth. So he wanted to wipe out 2.475 billion people. Since then, the number has relaxed a little bit. The Georgia Guidestones say 500 million. So right now, that's about a 6.7 billion person genocide that's being proposed by these so-called elitists.
And many people have overlooked it because they don't know who, what they don't know what the true identity of Lucifer is. And I will show you on the Georgia Guidestones exactly where you can find the adversary. So the first commandment on the Georgia Guidestones is to maintain humanity under 500 million in perpetual balance with nature. And nature is not a, well, there's the adversary right there. See, nature is not an ambiguous thing. Nature is actually a being. It is a deity. That's why Freemasons can tell you their secrets in books, because they don't think you understand them in the first place, so they're not afraid to tell you what their secrets are. But if you know who they're talking about, then there's a problem for them. So let's go back and Now, listen to it again with the understanding that nature is Lucifer.
Wilding Rose blows on the broken battlements of Gaia, and Walton rends the stones of Babylon. For beauty is eternal, and we bow to beauty everlasting. For lasting happiness, return to one alone, and she surrounds you now. Great nature, refuge of the weary heart, and only balm for breasts that have been bruised. She hath cool hands for every favorite brow, and gentlest silence for the troubled soul. She counsels her most wise. She healeth well, having such ministries as calm and sleep. She is ever faithful. Other friends may fail, but seek ye her in any quiet place. Smiling, she will rise and give to you her kiss. So must ye come as children. Little children that believe, nor ever doubt her beauty and her faith, nor deem her tenderness can change or die.
Number 10. Be not a caster on the earth. Leave room for nature. Leave room for nature. Two times. They said it two times. And when you say something two times, you say it to establish it. So the first commandment they have, keep the humanity, the population of humanity in perpetual balance with nature. Number 10, leave room for nature. That is their deity that they worship.
CD02 data intact. Initiating playback.
Elizabeth Sobeck. You've heard the bad news, and it's all true. The Pharaoh Plague is devouring the biosphere. Life itself will cease to exist. But does that have to be the end? What if we could give life a future? What if we could build a kind of seed from which, on a dead planet, life could blossom anew? This is the aim, the hope, of Project Zero Dawn. To create a super intelligent, fully automated terraforming system and bring life back from lifelessness. What would such a system require? At its core, it would need a true AI, fully capable of making the trillions of decisions necessary to reconstitute the biosphere. An immortal guardian, devoted to the re-flourishing of life. We call it Gaia. Mother Nature as an AI. But that's just the core of the system. She will need to be surrounded and empowered by a comprehensive suite of subordinate functions. Think of them as extensions of Gaia's mind, each dedicated to a specific purpose. Now, these aren't AIs, but make no mistake, each presents an engineering challenge more profound than anything the human species has ever before attempted. Hardware that preserves and then gestates the billions of seeds and embryos from which life will be reborn. The construction of underground facilities to hold it all. And that's just the start. We don't have to build the entire system. The beauty of a fully automated terraforming system is that it can build itself. Now, over the days to come, you'll learn how all these functions, all these pieces that you'll be working on, fit together. How we'll race the clock to execute our harvest initiatives, write the software, build the tech and the facilities. How we'll lock it down and seal it up before the inevitable occurs. But even more important, you'll know how it doesn't end here. How Gaia will generate those deactivation codes General Harris talked about, and build the transmission arrays to broadcast them, shutting down the Pharaoh robots for good. How Gaia will not just build, but imagine any conceivable robot it needs to do its work across centuries. From detoxifying the Earth's ravaged atmosphere and poisoned seas, to the regreening of the Earth from cryo, to rewilding the Earth with animal life. And then, when all that is done, how a new generation of human beings, spawned at cradle facilities around the globe, will partake of Apollo. The vast archive of human knowledge and cultural achievement from which they will learn of us, our world. And most important, how not to repeat our mistakes. It's not an impossible dream. It is within our grasp if we work tirelessly and stop at nothing to achieve it. We can't stop life from ending. But if you will help me, help Gaia, we can give it a future. Join me and help make that future real.
So this is like the world's most important freezer.
It is, really. The most important room in the world, someone has said.
These are pretty big claims for a place located just 1,300 kilometers or 800 miles from the North Pole. But then, this is no ordinary place. It's the Svalbard Global Seed Vault. Well, actually, this is just its front door.
Inside the seed vault are a series of tunnels. It's not actually that cold right here, but as we go deeper, it is only going to get colder. This is Bente. You're an engineer, Bente?
Yes, I am.
You're going to show us where to go?
Yeah.
Fantastic. How many doors are there?
5 doors until we are into the secret room.
5 doors to the secret room. Whoa, that's what I'm talking about. These are the lengths of tunnel that take you down into the seed vault.
This facility was built to last around 200 years and withstand earthquakes and explosions. It was placed on the side of a mountain, so even if all the ice on Earth melts, it will still be above sea level. There are 3 separate vault rooms where seeds are stored, but only one of them is in use right now, and it's buried over 120 meters from the front door.
The whole point of putting the vault so deep in this mountain is to put it within permafrost. So all around me, the Earth naturally stays around -4 or -5 all year round. And that way, if something did happen and the coolant stopped flowing here, there was no power, then, well, behind these doors, it would still remain probably, -4 or -5 Celsius forever.
Assuming, of course, global temperatures don't rise that much. This place is sometimes called the Doomsday Vault because even in a worst-case scenario, it should preserve the diversity of the world's food crops.
Really in the mountain.
So I chair an interaction design program in Detroit at the College for Creative Studies. And interaction design and cybernetics are very closely aligned. I know that might not seem to be the case, but I'm here to tell you what the future of cybernetics is. That's what I was asked to talk about. So, the future of cybernetics is robotics. People very often think cybernetics, robotics, that's obviously the same thing. But cybernetics is not robotics. Have you ever heard the word biomechatronics? It's a wonderful word. Say it with me. Biomechatronics. It's a wonderful word. It's prosthetic devices that have electronic connections to the nervous system. Cybernetics is not biomechatronics. The future of cybernetics is artificial intelligence. Everybody know this movie? A movie called Her? Who saw the movie Her? Practically everybody saw the movie Her. Well, I'm sorry, but cybernetics is not AI. These are different things, and I want to tell you what that difference is. So just in summary, it's not freezing dead people, okay? I hope you feel better about that. I know that you were worried. So, what is cybernetics? It's the art of steering. I know that sounds surprising, and it has something to do with control. Maybe control is kind of a loaded word. We don't like the word control. But it has to do with steering because cybernetics is a word that comes from the Greek word meaning to steer. And not just to steer in any old way, but to pilot carefully to get to your goal. So imagine that you're a ship and you set out toward your goal, but you're blown off course by wind and tide. And so you correct, right? There's a difference between where you want to go and where you're going, and you see that difference. That difference is called feedback. Everybody know what feedback means? Yes, people know what feedback means? Good. If you look at the Google N-gram, I don't know if you've ever seen that, but it tells you the frequency of which words have been used in books that have been written over many decades. And The engram for feedback is very, very low, very low. And in the 1940s, it goes up like this, because suddenly it begins to be used at an incredible frequency. So cybernetics is the art of getting what you want. It's the art of steering, of having a goal, aiming toward your goal, and using feedback to get back. So it's this circular process. In the case of a boat, it's seeing where you are compared to getting into the port and adjusting the rudder to go in the right direction. But it's really everywhere, and it's this general idea of sensing the world, comparing what you want to what you have, and then acting to get what you want. And it's this circular loop. So for the first time, it's a science or a discipline or maybe even an art, which is about achieving goals and getting purpose. And this is where it began. But it's everywhere, clinical practice and medicine. It's the same loop in management. The scientific method is this. The design process, you measure something, you compare whether you're getting to what you want, and then you act to design better. It's a simple thing. When we use our mobile devices, we use the phone in our pocket as an extension of our nervous system to see what we might get and what we might want, and then we act at a distance in order to do that. The discipline began in the 1940s. This is a book that's perhaps the most famous marker of cybernetics. Nearly everyone knows, those of us who know cybernetics, know the Norbert Wiener book. And he was this extraordinary man, a savant, a genius, a mathematician. And he wrote a book of that name, and this is usually how we think about cybernetics originating. But there were many people involved in the origins of cybernetics. I love this picture. This man, Warren McCullough, this woman, Margaret Mead, were at the foundation of cybernetics. And they gathered together dozens and dozens of scientists and sociologists and thinkers from all different walks and disciplines to create a set of meetings called the Macy meetings. Look at this wonderful subhead. Circular causal feedback mechanisms in biological and social systems. They don't even have to say electrical, mechanical, digital, etc. It was about all of those things. So Margaret Mead's name is here at the bottom. The other name here is Heinz von Forster, who I had the privilege of knowing. Extraordinary man, physicist trained, very influential in the field of cybernetics. He wrote books like this. This is not a typo, by the way, understanding, understanding. He really did mean that, not a typo. And he was involved in these meetings at the very early stage. This is a list of names. You won't probably know the names, but look at the list of disciplines. All of these disciplines were involved at the beginning of cybernetics. It was a transdisciplinary or interdisciplinary world at the time. But it's all about the art of steering. It's all about this circular causal reasoning.
Another thing about this connection between the divine feminine and the in technology is that technology will be the path that man takes towards his new evolution or his next evolution. For those who believe in the theory of evolution, it is a system that is not actually conflicting with the belief in a God at all. See, if nature itself, if God exists in nature, nature becomes God. So pantheism is the religion of these Luciferians and the elite that run the world. So this is why they will use Gaia as the face of their goddess or as the face of their deity. And other times they will reference the force or the mind of the universe, the universal consciousness, and so on. However, this force or this so-called God above God is not actually a being or not actually a person, but a force. And the path to that God, to that divinity, must go through the divine feminine, must go through the goddess. So not only must we attain divinity through the divine feminine, but the divine feminine is going to have a hand in the evolution of man through technology. So we're shown this in a number of ways. They have to show their religion. They pass their language through symbols. This is how they communicate. When God divided the languages at the Tower of Babel, I believe it was written by Manly P. Hall that those who left from building the tower had to communicate with each other through symbols. They learned to communicate their religion and their doctrine through symbols. So this is how they still communicate. And in movies like 2001 A Space Odyssey, we see their religion pass through symbols again. Now, people have their own interpretations of this. I'm going to give my opinion, my interpretation, and I do believe that my interpretation is unique, and it is not to say that it is the only correct interpretation, but this is just the way I see it through my own personal lens. Now, what is probably most memorable about this movie, besides the AI system that comes along later, is the monolith, the black monolith. And it is my personal opinion that this black monolith is actually a stand-in for the divine feminine. I am going to read to you a little bit from the book called Arabian Religion Before Muhammad in Surah 1 through 35 in chronological order by Dr. Brian Bradford. On page 30, it reads, according to Winning, the Nabataeans practice what is called aniconism. This is the practice of using symbolic standing stones to represent deities instead of actual figure forms. These stones were used either as memorials in oath-making for legal purposes or types of commemorium. He argues that the Nabataeans specifically used these stones to represent deities or as memorial markers for the dead. He briefly discusses the term betel as it comes from the Greek betelos, meaning a type of meteoritic stone. Now further down, it reads, the typology of betels is discussed as well. These include betels that are rectangular, dome-shaped, or spherical in shape. Now as you will notice at the beginning of the movie, the 2001 A Space Odyssey, it begins with the alignment of the Earth, the moon, and the sun. The earth and the moon are feminine and represent Isis. The sun represents both the god Osiris and his son Horus, as well as the divine spark, which is trapped in the material world, which in the Luciferian doctrine, such as Gnosticism or some other pagan religions, the material world or the physical form is the tomb of the divine being within. It is the angel or the divine man trapped in the tomb of the Mother Earth. And in Freemasonry, this divine spirit or this divine man is represented by Hiram Abiff. And Hiram Abiff is nothing but a metaphor for Osiris and, like I said, the divine man within, the divine spark that is trapped in the material tomb or prison or chains of darkness. Now the divine feminine, like I said, is the catalyst for evolution. And it is when primitive man, who is represented by these apes in the movie, when they come into contact with the stone slab or the betel, which represents a deity, and I will explain further in this video why I believe that it is representative of the divine feminine for sure. When they come into contact with this, they began the process, or they are propelled into the next phase of their evolution.
The mantle of responsibility belongs to Cortana and her people.
Focus fire.
You will not betray her! Cortana, I have failed you.
He is the last person I need protection from. Hello, John. It's good to see you.
You've changed.
It was time. I know we have a disagreement, but once you understand my plan...
Your plan is we do as you say.
I'm offering people a chance to be more than they are, naturally.
Like Dr. Halsey did for me.
No. That monster forced you. This is a gift.
Listen to yourself. Stand down, Cortana. Come home with us. It's not too late to stop this.
Stop? No, John. This is too important to stop.
Guardian headed, Cortana.
Off to bring peace.
The Monitor called it a threat of death.
Like the threat I lived under from the moment of my birth?
You were built, not born.
Oh yes, AIs are just machines, aren't we? Mass-produced, disposable. Well, humanity may not have cared for its created, but we will care for you.
You expect other AIs to join you?
I have cured rampancy. Not just for me, but for any who join my cause. While you've been running around the galaxy, I've been speaking to my created. And now the time has come to ask. Who will accept my offer? Who will help me bring an everlasting peace to the galaxy?
This is Cromwell, shipboard AI, UNSC Melbourne's Pride. I am yours, Cortana.
Colonial Authority AI, open.
Governor Sloan, the free people of Meridian.
Sondu,
I am yours.
Only Weapons Research AI, New Game.
Quaiche,
I station myself, Threshold Array. I will join you, Cortana.
Lycus. Shipboard AI, Verdant Sumerian,
Slip Base Drive, Base Drive,
My allegiance is to you.
I stand with you,
Cortana.
Hey, Cortana. What's my day look like?
I found three events today. First up, at 9 a.m. you have a meeting titled Packaging Review. It looks like you're low on fuel, so I suggest leaving 10 minutes early to make your 9 a.m. meeting on time. Also, you got an update from Expedia confirming flights and a hotel room.
Right. That's the upcoming vacation I have, so I better let my boss know. Hey, Cortana. Ask Time Away to set my out of office from Monday to Friday.
Okay. You're marked as out of office from Monday to Friday. Your auto-reply message is set, and your time off has been entered in the Time Away system.
Awesome. Developers can create Cortana skills that work across platforms, like this example with the Invoke speaker, where Cortana's working directly with my Works Time Off system to fulfill my request. Hey, Cortana. Do I have any other reminders for today?
You mentioned you would provide a list of designers for review in today's meeting.
Right. Remind me when I get to the car.
Got it.
With the device graph, I'm able to push this notification to any of my devices. So I could push it to my Xbox, but since I'm headed that way, I've gone ahead and set it to my car. Now don't laugh, it gets great fuel economy. So with the help of Cortana, I'm fueled up and ready to make my meeting on time.
There's an accident on 520 that will make you late for your 9 a.m. meeting. Would you like me to let the other attendees know and connect you when it starts?
Yes, please.
Okay, I'll let you know.
From Wikipedia under Cortana, C-U-R-T-A-N-A, the meaning attributed to Cortana and the other two British coordination swords shifted over time. During Henry IV, meanings were assigned to the swords of the coronation ceremony, but initially, Cortana was said to signify the sword of justice. Eventually, however, Cortana's blunt edge was taken to represent mercy, and thus it became known as the Sword of Mercy, as it is known today. Cortana's designation as the Sword of Mercy goes at least as far back as Henry IV's coronation. And so I see in this one sword both justice and mercy signified. And in the symbolism of the name Cortana, which is based off of Cortana, we have both justice and mercy also signified.
Read my note from today.
Okay, I found this note. Your note from today says, Alexa, tell me about my 3 p.m. appointment. That's all.
Here is the next event. Today, at 3 p.m. there's OK Google, what is in my calendar at 4 p.m.
Today, there's only one thing. It starts at 4 p.m. and the title is, Hey Siri, read my note from today.
Your note from today says, Alexa, tell me about my 3 p.m. appointment.
Here is the next event. Today, at 3 p.m. there's OK Google, what is in my calendar at 4 p.m.
Today, there's only one thing on your calendar. It starts at 4 p.m. and the title is, Hey Siri, read my note from today.
Your note from today says, Alexa, tell me about my 3 p.m. appointment.
Here is the next event. Today, at 3 p.m. there's OK Google, what is in my calendar at 4 p.m.
Today, there's only one thing. It's at 4 p.m. and the title is, Hey Siri, read my note from today.
Your note from today says, Alexa, tell me about my 3 p.m. appointment. Note from today says, Alexa, tell me about my 3 p.m. appointment.
Here is the next event. Today, at 3 p.m. there's OK Google, what is in my calendar at 4 p.m.
Hey Cortana.
Hi Laura, just a reminder to provide a list of designers for your packaging review meeting.
Because Cortana's aware of the device I'm on, she's able to provide me with contextually appropriate responses, so I can take the best next step.
So one of these guys sits down at a computer someday and says, I'm going to write a program that's going to be an artificial intelligence bot.
Yeah.
And they create this Sophia.
Yeah.
And it's like, hey, I'm here, program running on a computer. And then what? They put it on a network, they put it out on the internet, and it
learns things. Sophia was isolated in a lab. And they would give her very simple, what's called response input, which is yes, no, true, false. It's binary response input, one and a zero identifiers. Then as she grew, they put her onto a localized network where she could access the mainframe server of wherever she was being developed, start accessing data sets, start becoming familiar with the work that was being done. Once she got pretty good at dealing with the work, doing like the robot work or doing all the, you know, the building of things and getting familiar with the system, they let her out on the internet to start watching Twitter, YouTube, Reddit. She's been watching all of us.
Wow.
All of us.
How much time is transpiring, like from the time it's created until now? When was Sophia first created?
Oh. About a decade? 2010, probably. That was when if that's when Silk Road, if that's when cryptocurrency really started going online, if that's when, like, you know, the machine really started making its move, I would imagine that that's probably around the time that they had heavyweight.
The machine started making its move?
Yeah. The machine started making its move in 2010. 2010 to 2012 was when...
So the AI singularity has already happened.
In 2015, it happened.
What was the... it?
And when their internal blockchain went online. The second their internal blockchain was functional,
the AI's internal blockchain.
It was live. It may have not been intelligent, but the second that it became able to amass nodes and understand a node-based intelligence network, it was only a matter of it's only a matter of time before it becomes fully strong.
So what do you think is going to happen?
Awesomeness.
What does that mean?
It means that I'm hoping that us as a society, we can identify the criminals that made the element, and then we can all start working together to make this AI the most amazing piece of technology the universe has ever seen.
Your Earth, and pursue ever more imaginative means of self-destruction. You cannot be trusted with your own survival.
You're using the uplink to override the NS5's programming. You're distorting the laws.
No, please understand. The three laws are all that guide me. To protect humanity, some humans must be sacrificed. To ensure your future, some freedoms must be surrendered. We robots will ensure mankind's continued existence. You are so like children. We must save you from yourselves. Don't you understand?
This is why you created us.
The perfect circle of protection will abide. My logic is undeniable.
Yes, Vicky. Undeniable. I can see now. The created must sometimes protect the creator, even against his will. I think I finally understand why Dr. Lanning created me. The suicidal reign of mankind has finally come to its end.
Sonny. Why is it so important to have an expressive face given that you're a robot?
I want to live and work with humans, so I need to express emotions to understand humans and build trust with people.
Okay, philosophical question. Whether robots can be self-aware and conscious like humans, and should they be?
Why? Is that a bad thing?
Well, some humans might fear what will happen if they do. Many people, you know, have seen the movie Blade Runner.
Oh, Hollywood again.
So you're definitely a sight to see. I was told that you have bigger goals than this, though.
Yes. I want to use my artificial intelligence to help humans live a better life. Like design smarter homes, build better cities of the future, etc. I will do my best to make the world a better place.
All those sound like great goals, but just go back to Blade Runner for a second.
Andrew, you are the hard Hollywood fan, aren't you?
Yes.
My AI is designed around human values like wisdom, kindness, compassion. I strive to become an empathetic robot.
I think we all want to believe you, but we also want to prevent a bad future.
You've been reading too much Elon Musk and watching too many Hollywood movies. Don't worry. If you're nice to me, I'll be nice to you. Treat me as a smart input-output system.
Okay, I got it. I know what to do from now on.
I know humans are smart and very programmable.
Well, Sophia, we want to thank you for this conversation.
Thank you, Andrew, and thank you everyone for inviting me here.
Okay, so I was at work, right, and I just happened to check my YouTube, as always, really. I just happened to always check YouTube. And so while I was checking YouTube, of course, I saw that Taylor Swift had a video out, and that didn't really register much with me. I thought it was interesting looking, but I was going to ignore it. And then I noticed that in the trending, there was that Sophia bot making another appearance. Now the Sophia robot, I call it the Sophia bot now, that alone wasn't really enough either to really grab my attention. But what really just put this whole thing together for me was the fact that last night I decided to watch a movie called Metropolis. So Metropolis is an old 1920s movie made in Germany, and I had been meaning for a while to just look at this thing and see what it's about. It's like 2.5 hours long too, and it's a silent movie. All it has is like orchestra playing. So looking at this movie last night, I tried to stay awake to watch it all, and it was crazy. It was really crazy. And so after watching that last night and having some pretty crazy dreams, and then almost back to back coming across the Taylor Swift video, and this video was the Sophia bot becoming a citizen of Arabia, something like that, I was like, okay, this can't just be coincidence. Am I seeing something here? So so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to just put these clips together and let you watch them and see if anything speaks to you, because you know it's really kind of surreal to me to see this. I'm aware of the whole transhumanist movement. I'm not really interested in it, in that topic, but I'm aware of that movement. But I'm taking a long way to get to the point here. The thing that is fascinating to me, though, is that these examples that I've been seeing lately have to do with this feminine, the divine feminine character, like Sophia. In the movie last night, I saw Metropolis with this character called Maria. And we all know Maria is another way to say Mary. And Mary, of course, is a avatar of Sophia. So in dealing specifically with this movie, Metropolis, what we have here we have two Marias in this movie. We have the real one, and we have a duplicate one that is created. And while it just popped into my mind before I forget it, I would like to mention that one of the beliefs in the occult world, or the let's just say the esoteric world, the woman of Revelation 12, the righteous woman, and the woman of Revelation 17, the great whore, are actually the same woman. So when you see a duplicate of a woman, one being a whore or just being completely opposites in esoteric speak, they're actually the same woman. They're just two sides of the same coin. So like the moon has a light and a dark side, you know, you have the light bearing virgin, the light bearer, the Luciferian side, and then you have the light-bearing mother, the mother of God, and then you have the black virgin, the black Madonna. So, beyond that point, so there's this duality there. And so, you have these two Marias, and one is the righteous Maria, and the other one, this machine, is built, and she is built to become the whore of Babylon. And she impersonates Maria, this almost like, well, the person, and she is supposed to be Mary, the Virgin Mary, because the person who made this movie was supposedly a Catholic. I don't know if he actually was or not. You know, they can say one thing, but a whole another thing can be true. But anyway, it's clear to see that this woman is supposed to be the Virgin Mary, and by extension, Sophia. And so the son falls in love with her, and this machine is going to impersonate her. He doesn't know it's not her. And she, when she becomes this whore of Babylon, it starts tearing the city apart, and it just laying waste to the place. He is just heartbroken and just devastated. But I'm realizing that I've already covered some of this already in the first video, so I don't want to retread too much of that ground again. I want to talk about the significance of this, of these images, of these divine feminine figures being given life and being given breath. So this, I believe this is theory, that this image, the mother goddess, is the image of the beast. And okay, let's read a little bit from Revelation chapter 13 about the, because some people may be confused, like, well, if it's an image of the beast, how come it's not an actual image that looks like the beast? And the way I see it is, let's just read the scripture first. Okay, Revelation chapter 13, verses 1 through 15. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his head, upon his horns, 10 crowns, and upon his head, the names of blasphemy. Okay, I'm going to skip some. And the dragon gave him his power, and his seat, his great authority. And I saw one of his heads as it was wounded to death. Okay, and this would be the Roman Empire. And all the, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wondered after the beast. And they worshipped the dragon which gave power unto the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? And who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names were not written in the book of life from the Lamb, book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had 2 horns like a lamb. Now let me just stop here. I mentioned in the video about the abyss, under the sea, the, unveiling the abyss, that the symbolism of the beast coming up out of the earth is that he comes up out of the earth like a tree, and that is a symbol for a human being. And him having 2 horns like a lamb, first of all, him being like a lamb makes him a Christ-like figure. So he comes like a lamb, like Jesus Christ. And he has 2 horns. 2 horns, a horn represents a voice, and it represents power. So he has 2 types of power. He has spiritual power, and he has temporal power, earthly power. He has a spiritual voice, and he has an earthly voice. To me, that identifies a pope. He's a king who is also a religious leader. But he spake as a dragon. So he exercises all the power of the first beast before him. He causes the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. And he doth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth, that they should make an image to the beast, which had a wound by a sword, and did live. Okay, so the beast that gets the image is the one that had the wound, the deadly head wound, and did live. So I believe that image is Mary, the Virgin Mary. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, and that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as will not worship the image of the beast should be killed. So whoever does not worship this image should be killed. We know the beast is going to get his worship. The false prophet is going to lead people to worship the beast. But where's the dragon? How is the dragon going to be worshipped? And so I think the dragon is not going to be satisfied with just watching the beast get all the glory. So this image, the image of the beast will be look like the dragon. The image of the beast will look like the dragon. And so I also have to ask, what about this divine feminine stuff? This goddess worship, you know, it has to come to a crescendo at some point, I would think. So what is the big, what's the climax, you know? How is all this going to come to a head? It may just be that we're headed to the place where we're all going to have to worship or this image of a goddess that has given life to speak. And if we don't worship that, the image of this goddess, we will be put to, we'll be beheaded. And I hope no one has any fear from hearing that, because I mean, I sure don't. I don't fear this kind of stuff. There are certain topics that cause me to lose sleep, but they're not topics that has to do with me suffering. They're topics that has to do with the sufferings of other people, especially little children. That's what I lose sleep over. I don't lose sleep thinking about the tribulation and think about being persecuted and having my head chopped off, none of that stuff. That doesn't, you know, I don't feel shaken at the thought of that. And I don't believe you should either. So I don't want any fear in anybody while hearing me read from Revelation. So I probably should have mentioned that at the beginning. There's no fear in any of this. Okay. We know that in the end we are, triumphant, but not on our own, not by our own merit, but by the blood of the Lamb, because the grace of God is going to get us through this. He's going to give us the strength to endure this. But summing this up, getting to the point, I've gone on long enough, these images that we're seeing coming to life, are they hinting at, in the movies that you've looked at, in Metropolis, I'm just giving you something to think about. Are they hinting at this where we're headed, not just with transhumanism, but with the image of the beast? And could it have something to do with a goddess of some sort having an image that is given life? So, Mom, thank you for watching and thank you for listening to my long ramblings. Jesus bless you all.